please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
You're with us here on a fresh new edition of Midcap Radar. The market is up 30 points. It's a good-looking screen. It was not so a little earlier in the day, but it is now. That's about a third of a percent higher. The futures premium of about 20 points still holds. Public sector banks, metals, infrastructure, the three areas, I mean three sectoral indices which have got gains in excess of 1%. By far, leader, of course, is the PSU bank space. Sumira, good afternoon.
Hi, Prashant. Good afternoon to you as well. Let's also take a check on how the European markets have opened. And I wondered if we've got a bit of a bump up from there as well, because the opening was expected to be good. And along expected lines, the market's about a quarter to half a percent higher, reacting to the slew of financial sector reforms that have been announced yesterday in Europe. So good going on that front.
The other story, which I think is has gotten a fair bit of traction, is the entire Aadhaar leak story. I mean, essentially, an investigation was put out by a newspaper, and it essentially said that their investigation showed that it took basically 10 minutes and 500 rupees for their reporter to access any Aadhaar sort of number or Aadhaar profile. I mean, all the data was available. Now we've got a clarification from the authority, UIDAI, which essentially says that we assure you that there has not been any Aadhaar data breach. Aadhaar data, including biometric information, is fully safe and secure. So this is an important clarification which is coming in. I mean, you know, this entire the story by the newspaper has got a lot of people worried. It's kind of doing the rounds on social media, etc. We've got a clarification now coming in from the authority itself, which administers the Aadhaar program. Let's get back to the market. 30 points on the Nifty. Ashwani Gujral is with us. Ashwani, thanks very much. Good afternoon. Your sense on things and whether this market will go higher later in the day.
Well, it appears that, you know, the lower end of the range has been tested quite a bit. And now, particularly with banks moving up, the market is showing much better resilience than earlier. And towards the end, we could rally some more, given that, you know, private banks could also participate, HDFC Bank particularly. Now, overall, it doesn't change the scenario. Basically, we are stuck in that range, and you know, we need to move back above 10,550 for anything substantial to change. But within the range, you can say that we are now looking for some sort of an upswing. Having said that, I think PC Jeweler and Titan both are doing well. So PC Jeweler is a buy with a stop of 476, target of 500. Larsen, which is making an all-time high, that is a buy with a stop of 1295, target of 1350. And Jain Irrigation is a buy with a stop of 131, target of 144.
Ashwani, the other stock, as you said, PC Jewelers, Titans, both are doing well. The other is TBZ, Tribhuvan Das. No real movement or anything of that sort, but what would you make of the chart just looking at it?
See, it hasn't really done what these guys have done. Now, I don't know what is the reason, some stock-specific issue, but it's an underperformer. If somebody must buy it, maybe keep a stop, say, below 110, and then look for targets of about 148.
Okay. Ashwani, thank you very much. We speak with you in an hour's time. Sumira.
All right, well, let's take a quick break. But as we do that, we leave you with some market opinion that's coming from Tushar Pradhan of HSBC Global AMC. So hear out his India strategy for 2018.
Going forward, the expectation is that the earnings are going to come back. Now, there is going to be a midpoint between where the elevated earnings P ratio and the earnings growth actually do match and come together. If I were to be a theoretician and to say that, you know, the market always will trade at a fair value, that's somewhere where it is right now, which means that once the earnings actually catch up, you will find a normalization of the PE ratio over the last 15-year average. there is going to be some volatility. I believe that is because of all the news flow, which is so now, I would think, you know, jammed up in the first half of the year. So you've got a budget coming up, everything to be curious about what the slippage is all about. You've got a lot of elections coming through the entire year as such. That will always lend some volatility. What happened last year, the level of benign market atmosphere was not very visible at the start of the year or throughout the year. If you see, the news flow continued to bother people. So it was not as if there was euphoria. There was a lot of caution, and I think the caution persists into the new year. So this is again a very good sign from my point of view.
Market has perked up about 0.4% higher, and one stock in particular that's buzzing in trade today is PG Electro Plus. The stock is up about 7.5% and it's seeing higher than normal volumes as well. Vikas Gupta, the ED of the company, now joins in. Mr. Gupta, thanks very much for speaking with us. The first thing that I want to actually talk to you about is the recent stake sale by the promoters. So I think your shareholding from 65% has come down to under 62%. So is there any reason that the promoters sold this stake, and what is the plan now? Would this money be plowed back into the company?
Yeah, good afternoon. The promoters have sold 5 lakh shares, and the stakeholding of the promoters have come down to around 61.96%, that is around 62%. The proceeds from the sales will be infused back into the company as an unsecured zero coupon loan to the company. With this infusion, the company's ongoing growth plans will get further boost, and the capex and the working capital requirements will be met completely.
Okay. So is there any further plan to bring down stake, or this is it for now?
This is just for the now. Like, we are already, we have met our requirement for the capex, so there will not be any further dilution of the promoter stake.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mr. Gupta, what will this money be used for? In what area?
We have an ongoing capex plan. Hmm. So there was a partial requirement for funding of that. So it will be used for that capex.
No, I'm saying, so which line, which product segment, for example, to be specific?
So we are expanding our capacity in plastic injection molding also. And we have recently installed a PU painting line. So we are using the proceeds for those capex.
Hmm. Okay, so you said this is partially funding your capex, right? So what is the balance that's left, and how are you looking to fulfill that?
We have already tied up the finances with the bankers, and for that we already took some term loan.
Okay, what's the total debt as of now?
The total long-term debt will be around 65 crores.
Okay, so would you have any more requirement for funding for FY18 post this?
No, not as of now. Okay. I can't see that.
Okay. So in that case, sir, what is the visibility on the full year? I mean, you know, given that for Q2, I think you've done about, 50 lakhs in terms of your profit. Although in the first half, I think you've seen about a 200% growth, right, on the bottom line. What are you hoping to wrap up FY18 with?
It will be difficult to give a forward-looking number, but we are looking at to maintain the same growth pace that we have experienced in last quarter also. Hmm. So we see a healthy numbers growth in this full year also. Okay.
Sorry, I must correct myself. I'd refer to your FY17 number. For Q2 FY18, you've done 20 crores. My
yes,
mistake.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Just quickly, I mean, so in FY18, could you tell us in terms of net profits, what could you end up at? I mean, FY16, I think you did about, the annual report says just under 2 crores.
Mm-hmm.
FY17 was about 3.7. What would FY18 mm-hmm. look like?
As you know, it will be difficult to give a definite specific number, a forward-looking number.
Mm.
But we are hopeful of a healthy and a strong growth in FY18.
Mm. So can you, I mean, you doubled it in between 16 and 17. Can you come close to that performance? Growth rate
yeah,
wise
sure. Yeah,
in 18,
yeah,
18
yeah.
over 17.
Yes. Yeah, sure.
So it could be closer to under 8 crores or so, possible.
Sorry, I cannot commit on that. But
okay, no problem.
We'll maintain a growth rate.
Okay, no, the reason I'm asking that is because it's a very low margin business, right? The revenues are substantial, but profits at the end of the day. And I mean, your annual report, you highlight that. You say that you're in a business where the OEMs are always have to be globally price competitive. So they're always looking to cut costs, and in turn, you have to be efficient. So just, I mean, how will this work? Is just the size of the business will keep expanding and margins remain there? So they, I mean, you know, so net profits will also grow at that rate? Or is there anything else that you can do?
Like we have told previously also to you, we have just recently set up a PU paint shop. And I would say almost last year, we established our tooling line, tooling infrastructure. So these two businesses are small in size, but they contribute substantially to the EBITDA margins. And we feel that the EBITDA margins will start improving. In case, if you look at the numbers for the quarter two also, our EBITDA margins have improved to almost 9% previous year. So we see a strong growth, and additionally, we are trying to focus on an ODM segment where we are giving a complete product to our customers like washing machines and air coolers. There we have a better control over supply chain and the vendor pricing. So there the margins are much better. So we are trying to focus on that business and try to grow that business so that our profitability margin improves.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but you plan to? Do you plan to ever get into consumer electronics yourself? I mean, brand it under your own brand and sell them, or no? I mean, you will.
No. We are not looking at launching our own brand. Our core strength lies in manufacturing.
Sure.
So we will focus on that only.
Sorry, the two segments that you said. What were they? You said that margins are higher in those two segments. Which are those?
The PU painting line that we have recently set up and the tooling infrastructure. Where we make the tools for our customers.
Oh, okay. Tooling and painting, you said, right?
Yes.
All right. I think that's it for now, Mr. Gupta. Good luck. Thanks very much for taking out the time and speaking with us. Appreciate you joining in. So that's PG Electroplast. I mean, actually, the other listed competitor in the space is Dixon, which listed just a few months back, if you can put that stock up. That has had a phenomenal rise. Not that PG has not had. I mean, I think this one came to the market. Dixon came to the market at about 2,800 rupees. It's at 4,200. PG, on the other hand, 1 year back was, I think, about 120, 150 rupees. It's 400 plus. So, I mean, both have had very, very strong rallies. And now we understand that there is one more company which, in the same space, contract manufacturing, consumer appliances, electronics, which is also coming up with an IPO. So there'll be three in that particular space. In the listed sphere. 3-point premium on the futures. The Nifty itself has got 50 points. So, I mean, we must actually take a quick stock of what's moving on the Nifty because there is more, I mean, traction which is coming up very fast now. I mean, put these stocks up and I think you'd be better able to see where these gains are coming from. So, L&T, I mean, adding the most index points. It's not necessarily moved the most in the last couple of minutes, but it is adding the most. HDFC Bank is the number two spot. You look at something like a State Bank of India, and then Tata Steel, ONGC, and Reliance Industries, which are contributing a fair bit as well. So this is where bulk of the gains are coming from. So from being 20-25 points higher for most of the day, till about, what, half an hour, 40 minutes back, we are now up 50 points. At 10,493, approaching the 10,500 mark quickly. Tata Motors, though, still remains lower in trade. It's JLR sales in the US market, which is the most important market for the company, declined for the month of December. Sonia is here to take us through the numbers quickly. Sonia, over to you.
Well, the numbers are looking weak. No two ways about that. And, you know, America is a very important market for Jaguar Land Rover. 25% of their contribution comes from the American market. It has been slowing down for the last few months. In fact, not just JLR, but Audi, Mercedes, etc. have also reported weak sales from the American market. So across the industry, it seems to be, you know, a trend. This time around, numbers look weak. The US sales are down 9.5%. The month-on-month numbers look good because December is traditionally a strong month for retail sales across the U.S. That's why the month-on-month comparison may not be fair, but year-on-year, it's actually a fall of 20% that Jaguar has seen. And, you know, this is the reason the stock, Tata Motors, refuses to outperform or even perform in line with the industry. I mean, if you look at it, over the last 1 year, Tata Motors has done nothing because either the North America market is slowing down or the Chinese piece is not working. And until that doesn't come together, you know, there will not be outperformance from the stock. Also, a lot of the analysts have been indicating to me that this quarter, we could see a bit of a slippage in terms of the margin performance, purely because even the Chinese market has not grown as good as was expected earlier.
Sonia, thanks very much for that. In fact, let's stay with the auto space. Ashok Leyland, the management spoke with us earlier this morning, and you know, the company has reported their highest ever commercial vehicle sales in the month of December. So we spoke with the CFO, Gopal Mahadevan, in a bit to try and find out whether or not demand has picked up. And the management sounds extremely confident of demand and the forecast for 2018. Okay, so that was, we'll come to that in a bit. For now, let's focus on IDEA for the moment. And my colleague Nisha Podar had broken the story earlier this morning that IDEA would be looking at fundraising. We now get confirmation that the board of IDEA has approved raising up to 3,250 odd crores. I think the number that she was working with was also very, very close. It was in this region.
About $500 million, which translates
roughly
to approximately
about,
this.
Yeah,
absolutely.
3,000 odd crores. So, once again, you know, a confirmation coming through that the board of IDEA has approved this fundraising plan, 3,250 crores on a preferential basis, and the stock seems to be perking up just a tad. But we'll try and get Nisha in just a moment to try and address this news. But good going.
Good going. And this is, as Nisha was telling us, essentially as the merger is happening, this would be to basically allow the promoters to hold on to their stake in the company. Mm. I mean, the merged entity. We're getting some more details. So, allot up to 32 crore shares at 99 rupees and 50 paise. So, this is a preferential allotment which we are talking about. I think Nisha is with us now in the studios. Nisha, over to you.
That's right, Prashant. In fact, we were penciling in around $500 million kind of a fundraise by IDEA Cellular, but it's not as simple. In fact, we need more details, and we will need an analysis also of what on preferential basis and to whom. If we have more details on that, that'll be very important because the entire structure is quite complicated. If we have more details,
out to you. Yeah. So. The shares would be issued at an issue price of 99.50 per equity shares, including a premium of 89.50 to Birla TMT Holdings Private Limited and or Elaine Investments Singapore and or Oriana Investments Singapore and or Surya Kiran Investments Singapore on a preferential basis for an aggregate consideration of 3250 crores.
All right. So these are the existing you know, shareholders of IDEA Cellular to which a preferential allotment is being done. And it will be because of the requirement of the mega merger with Vodafone, which is underway. Shareholding as well as the capital structure is something that needs to be kept in mind. Mr. Kulkarni, who tracks the telecom sector very closely, joins in on the phone line. So my first question, what do you make of the 3,000 odd crore rupees of fundraise through preferential basis, and how is it linked to the Vodafone transaction that is underway?
So Vodafone transaction is altogether a different action. So that the structure for that is already decided, right? So the ratio will be 1:1 and things like that. So eventually Vodafone will own probably 50% in the business, and then they will sell some stake to the promoter group of IDEA Cellular. So that's altogether a different transaction. This is more to do with the company wanting to launch more broadband sites and also wanting to launch voltage services during the calendar year. So this is pertaining to that. So I don't see a huge link between these two, but of course, the capital requirement was there for IDEA Cellular, and they are taking steps to work out on that.
All right. And the press release also says, Naveen, that the board has also constituted a committee of directors to evaluate the potential routes for raising further capital of 3,500 odd crore rupees, such as further preferential issue or through QIPs as well as rights issue. So in total, we are talking about about 7,000 odd crore rupees of total fundraise by Idea Cellular. How do you see this panning out and how will it augur for the stock going forward, because the debt equity levels is at about 2.2, the ratio is at 2.2, and there's a lot of hue and cry about the kind of leverage that most of the telecom companies are really dealing with, especially Idea Cellular.
Yeah, so that was the challenge, right? So if you look at more than the debt to equity ratio, what has been a concerning number is the net debt to EBITDA number. So EBITDA has been under quite a bit of pressure, and after the IUC rate cut, of course, there will be more pressure on the EBITDA margins and the absolute EBITDA. So raising some bit of capital would definitely help them to improve their product offering and retain the customers and also gain customers. So this is more of a growth capability is what I tend to see, and it was very important for the company to have more breathing space because the kind of debt the company was having, so there was very limited room for limited options that the company had in network expansion. So I think they have done the right thing to improve their capital structure, which makes them much more agile to meet the market needs.
All right, Naveen, hold your thoughts there. We also have Rohit Chordia also joining us on the phone line, Rohit. We will reconnect with Rohit. But Naveen, one more question to you in the interim, while we are talking about the merger going through. How do you see the capital structure in this particular fundraising case? And what sources had told us was that the next tranche, which is 3,500 odd crore rupees, which is still under deliberation, could be through rights issue because they cannot really touch the promoter holding an idea. And on the other hand, they cannot tinker with the capital structure of the company ahead of the merger, because that has to really adhere to the guidelines and the clauses that they both the parties have really agreed to.
Yeah, so that again, whatever are the guidelines that have been agreed upon, I think those things will be followed. I don't think so there is any doubt, because the merger is of course still the most important and the critical event ahead, and I think so both the companies are quite cognizant of not disturbing that at in any case. So that I don't think so there is going to be any challenges with regards to merger with any change in capital structure right now.
Right, looks positive. Naveen, just one final word. Does it call for a re-rating of the stock with 7,000 odd crore rupees that is going to be raised, which will deleverage the company overall?
Yeah, so of course, 7,000 crores is 7,000 crores, and plus they are selling off the tower, so that will also, some capital will also start coming in once all the approvals are in place. So the company is taking proactive steps in deleveraging and also their ability to improve their network quality, which has been, I would say, a question mark in the recent times, where the others have invested a lot of capital in improving their network quality and product offering. So that is one step that the company had to take, and they have made the taken the right step in that direction.
All right, thanks Naveen for joining us. So all, in two tranches, Idea Cellular is going in for a massive fundraising program, 3,250 crore rupees. That is going to be done through preferential allotment of shares. And the second tranche will be also important, 3,500 odd crore rupees. And on that, the company will be deciding on the route. Sources do suggest that there could be a rights issue that is under deliberation at this point. So all in all, about 7,000 odd crore rupees of fundraising program for Idea Cellular. Market is taking it very, very positively because it will deleverage and also help them in expansion to fight the competition in the telecom sector, Sumaira.
All right, Nisha, thanks very much, and congratulations on getting it right once again.